Getting turn-by-turn directions from your mobile phone has become a part of life for many people who drive.
Turn right onto 26th Street.
That's lured more companies into the lucrative business of using digital maps because there's money to be made. Until September, almost all those phone maps were supplied by Google. But when Apple introduced the new iPhone 5, it replaced Google Maps with its own and learned quickly that map making is fraught with peril. Immediately, users complained they got lost. Some landmarks were out of place. Directions were misleading. Apple CEO Tim Cook apologized, but still, satirists had a field day with the misdirections. The stakes in the mapping game are high for Apple and others, since a lot of advertising revenue depends on knowing the location of the phone and promoting something nearby, a restaurant or a hotel, to the user.
And that's maps that replaces.
Carolina Milanese, an analyst for Gartner, a technology research firm, says Apple wants to capitalize on that.
Apple needs to own maps. They need to own location. The end game is knowing your location so that you can monetize from that knowledge, knowing what the consumers do, where they are, and what they do where.
Google or Apple can deliver paid advertising to users based on their current location or where they intend to go. There's also plenty of one-upsmanship in the map-making business, where pizzazz on the screen is attractive and useful to someone like David Rumsey, a San Francisco map collector with a healthy respect for Apple's efforts in digital map-making. He runs Apple Maps on one iPad and Google Maps on his other.
What's interesting about the Apple is we are in 3D, so as we zoom in, we can change and see the whole scene in three dimensions. In Google Maps, we can zoom in, of course, and the resolution is just as good, but we don't see it in 3D. In order to see it in 3D, we go into Google Earth. So Google's got two applications. Apple's rolled it all into one. As a collector, I'd say I want them both.
Rumsey acknowledges that making maps always has been difficult, costly, and labor-intensive. Google is usually regarded as the leader in the digital world of maps, with everything from Skyview to Street View to Google Earth contributing to its displays. Brian McClendon is vice president of Google Maps.
Making maps is incredibly hard. When Google started in 2005, we really only had the United States and the United Kingdom on the map at all. We worked very hard. We bought data from as many providers who had already been making maps before and tried to bring them together into a unified single interface. The US government's actually a very good source for sort of raw map data, but it doesn't make a good map on its own. You need to do a lot of work to massage it. The word for it is conflation, to bring multiple sources of data together and produce a high quality single source that can answer all of the questions that the user would ask.
The company began making its own maps in 2008. It won't say how many people it devotes to map making, but indications are it's in the thousands, including the drivers of the Street View cars that travel the streets in 43 countries, continuously taking photos with 9 onboard cameras.
We also have GPSs on board, and we're able to combine the imagery plus the GPS to provide precise location information about where the picture was taken. And this helps us actually locate businesses, locate street addresses that are far higher precision than any map makers had before.
As the field progresses, the company is gathering more and more data, including pictures from camera-equipped trikes, which roam business sites, university campuses, and parks to map trails, pathways, and buildings. The pictures not only contribute to digital maps, but they also provide detailed images of each street, its businesses, its neighborhood. Engineering supervisor Michael Weiss-Malik's job is to integrate it all using a tool called Atlas.
You might get roads from one data provider and house addresses from another. So we can turn on, say, data from the U.S. Geological Survey, which are very old paper maps, actually, that have been scanned in. The photos come from satellite imagery and from aerial imagery that Google collects. We fly planes to collect aerial imagery. The blue lines are the data that come from the census.
The challenge is to keep the maps constantly updated as roads and buildings change.
So the problem with making a map is that it's never done. The world keeps changing. The great thing that we have is that we're able to fix it really quickly.
Much of the conflation work is automated, but not all.
A large chunk of it is actually manual, where we go through and align these by dragging them around on the satellite imagery to make sure that everything looks just right.
For map makers, responding to change has always been difficult. Collector Rumsey, who recently donated more than 150,000 maps to Stanford University, says maps always have had errors.
No map is ever perfect. As you can see from some of these maps, they showed California as an island hundreds of years ago, and it took a long time for that to actually get removed from the maps. In the old maps, it often took 100 years, maybe 200 years.
Google and others can react more quickly because of the input they get. Thousands of times a day, people all over the world tell Google via the internet that roads or signage or stores or parks have changed, or that their own neighborhood is poorly represented and the company needs to update its maps. Google investigates the alleged errors and tries to correct them. The concept of having people on the ground change the map is called crowdsourcing. And it's the principle pioneered by an Israeli-based mapping company called Waze. That firm, with a small Palo Alto office, uses GPS to track the location of 27 million drivers who have downloaded its app. Waze depends on that crowd to update its maps, determine traffic congestion, and direct users to alternate routes.
So while you're getting a free navigation service, you're also contributing to the community.
Waze Vice President Diane Eisner says crowdsourcing is altering map making.
The crowd will not only help you get the more accurate information, because you've got millions and millions of people who care enough to make sure that their view of the world is represented, and at the same time, they are making sure that things are updated.
Eisner says Apple didn't use crowdsourcing, a strategy many analysts say might have saved it recent embarrassment.
The Apple path was, let's see what sources are out there already, let's add our own technology to bring it together, but let's not actually create our own maps. Which is a fine strategy, but it means that they lose control.
For its part, Apple has said little publicly, except, of course, for Tim Cook's letter to his customers apologizing for their frustration and pledging to make the maps work better. Apple declined our request for an interview. Carolina Milanese at Gartner Research says that Apple's mistakes coming so soon after Steve Jobs' death last year probably won't have long-term effects on the company.
A lot of people are looking to question, is Apple ever going to be the same company? And I think what you've seen there in that apology was the reassurance that the core of Apple, the focus on excelling in what they do, is still there. But the end game, they need to invest time and money.
And that's just what Google, Apple, Waze, and a few other players, including Nokia, TomTom, and OpenStreetMaps, will all be doing, vying for a bigger niche of the exploding market for maps and advertising.